Take a half a step this way. Okay. That's it. Okay, are we kind of... I know what I better do, just check my sound on this. It's kind of nice, the black is good. Yeah, yeah. There was one singer I knew who used to always first, she'd start the day by checking if her voice was there. She'd go, okay. The high, those kind of crazy sounds.
The piece that's being made here is designed to be shown on the fire screen at La Fenice Opera House in Venice. And the principle is that they get have a projection on the fire screen while the audience comes in and the orchestra is tuning up.
Hello, this is the... this is the pianist calling, all the way from William's house.
Okay, what I'll do is I'll play you some chords, and then I'm going to kind of play along with you a little bit, okay?
Okay.
Hold on, I'm going to speak to you now, hold on. Okay, let's put that there. Just talk a bit, sing a bit, talk a bit. Good, hang on, I'm just trying to line this up. That's all right. Okay, all right, here we go. All right. Can you hear the... Okay, when you're ready. Kimmy, stop.
Okay.
Okay. Let's just do that phrase.
Let me just say something to you and Philip.
Okay.
Okay, to both of you. Phil, sorry, William here. One of the things that would be good is to not so much repeat a whole phrase, but to jump to break in the middle of a phrase and repeat. So like where you've got babbo pietà, but to babbo pie, mm-hmm. Trying this. When you complete it at the ta, it feels too elegant as a completed gesture.
I work with a wonderful opera singer who lives in Cape Town. So I called her and I said, Kimmy, would you sing this aria down the phone and I'll sort of sit at the piano and give you the key. It has a sort of uncanny sound of both old and modern and contemporary.
Initially, I think he'd done the recording on the cell phone as a guide track. And then we heard the recording on the cell phone and said, let's keep it and work with that strange Caruso-esque old quality of the voice. Which is why today we're working with images of Kimmy on the cell phone.
It was just one of those moments which happened when I work with William where we both went off and played and the playing worked. That's one of the things about working with William that I enjoy so much is the ability to play and experiment.
The first promptings to work as an artist are still there. The questions haven't changed. How does one find a way of not necessarily illustrating the society that one lives in, but allowing what happens there to be part of the work, part of the vocabulary, part of the raw material that is dealt with? South Africa is very much part of the work. important thing about the first animated films I made is they were done as a response to doing something which I thought I understood, which was making charcoal drawings. So they were done on the basis of trying to get away from a program of doing drawings, having exhibitions in which I could see my life heading out ahead of me, 30 more solo exhibitions of charcoal drawings. So I decided I had to do something that couldn't possibly fit into that context, that wasn't going to be in a gallery, that was done for my own interest and pleasure. And Soho and Felix came out of that. There was no expectation they would be part of real work I was doing, that they would have to be understood or justify themselves in a broader world at all, or that they had to even have a logic to them. It doesn't matter if there isn't a story because it's not trying to sell it to a producer. It's not starting with distribution. It's starting with its own crazy logic. So it doesn't matter who these two characters are, what their names are. They don't have to represent anyone but themselves in the film. It took me a long time to kind of understand that, and that was the substantive work I was doing. And so that experience gave me a lot of confidence in the validity of working without a program, without the essay being written in advance. I made a decision. I would never, ever write a script. I would never write a storyboard. I would never, ever write a proposal. The history of Jews in South Africa is quite complex in the sense that there were, as there are in all parts of the world, an absolute overrepresentative number of Jewish people who were involved in liberation struggles, in fights against apartheid, who had very honorable ethical and moral lives. But there are also a large number of Jewish people who did very well under the nationalist government, who made a lot of money through it. The depiction of Soho and Felix are both Jewish. So when they say, oh, Soho's a Jewish businessman, has to do with that double edge. It would have been very easy to have done, so, okay, I'm going to draw a terrible Afrikaner and make him entirely separate and distant from myself. Whereas the Soho is a kind of understanding that that's part of who I am. The pinstripe, someone who always wears a pinstripe tip, is from a photograph of my grandfather. The two names came out of a dream, and it came out of the period when I said, I'm making this film for myself. I don't have to question who these names are, what they mean. They then understood later on that they're both a kind of self-portrait, self-portrait in the third person. To place self-portrait. So the films have had to either defend themselves or ignore, but they've certainly been accused of anti-Semitism. In many ways, the work seems unbearably Semitic to me, in the sense it deals endlessly with memory, with loss, all the kind of cliches that you think, oh, this is what a Jewish artist is going to be talking about. And it's kind of a distressing for me that they get stuck in that terrain, but that is where they are. The films opened an enormous door because they gave me a sense of it was possible to work without a program in advance, and that it was possible to make a film without first having written a script. That if you work conscientiously and hard at it, and there is something inside you that is of interest, that is what will come out. You yourself will be the film. The film will always be you. I think a lot of the work that I've done since then, even if it's not using that technique, has certainly used that strategy, the understanding that images in movement as well as static images are a key thing for me to be working on. The provisionality of drawings, the fact that they're going to be succeeded by the next stage of the drawing, was very good for someone who's bad at knowing when to commit something to being finished. Say, when is this drawing finished? Here the drawing would go on till the sequence was finished in the film, and that would be the end point of the drawing. Understanding of the world as process rather than as fact. You know, temperamentally, all of those things made sense to me, and intellectually they made sense to me. And somehow this technique and this medium emphasized or allowed that to come forward. The anamorphic film, What Will Come Has Already Come, which is about the Italian-Ethiopian War of the 1930s, works on the principle that what is distorted in the projection gets corrected in the viewer's seeing of it in a mirror. So the distortion is the correction, and the original is the distorted. One of the things of doing the film or doing the drawings was learning the grammar of the transformations that happen when you go from a flat surface to the curved mirror. So that, for example, to draw a straight line is relatively complicated, because every straight line is in fact a curve, whereas every straight line that you draw becomes a parabola. So looped telephone wires are very easy. Simply draw a series of straight lines on the drawing, and the lines will loop themselves around the surface of the cylinder. Whereas if you want a straight line, you've got to calculate a not obvious curve on the sheet of paper. I'm interested in machines that tell you what it is to look, that make you aware of the process of seeing, and make you aware of what you do when you construct the world by looking at it. But more as looking and seeing being a metaphor or a broad-based metaphor for how we go through the world, how we understand the world, for thinking or understanding. When you look through a stereoscopic viewer, you're aware that you have two completely flat images, and that all that is happening is that your brain, not the images, but your brain is constructing an illusion of three-dimensional depth, which is very clear when you look at the stereoscopic viewer because you know you're seeing two flat images. What's much less obvious is that that's what we're doing all the time in the world. Our retinas are each receiving flat images, and our brain combines the two images from our retinas into this illusion of coherent depth. And because we do it so well, we believe that's what we're seeing. We believe we are simply seeing depth rather than we are constructing depth out of two flat images in our eyes. So that, again, it's both interesting about the phenomenon and the wow factor of stereoscopes always. But it's more about the agency we have, whether we like it or not, to make sense of the world. When the Metropolitan Opera said they wanted me to do an opera, we spent a long time trying to find one that seemed appropriate. They suggested Shostakovich. I said, yes to Shostakovich, but first prize for me would be to do Gogol's story, The Nose. I've always wanted to do a Russian project, which is to say a project in which all those different things could be looked at, which is the political history, the formal elements of modernism and constructivism, and the poetry and the writing. They all come into the production of The Nose, not all of them into the opera, of course, but chunks of them into what we had at Sydney, I'm Not Me, The Horse Is Not Mine, and various other iterations of the material. There'll be house lights on and all the projections off, and people come in. Then he'll switch the house lights off, and I think the two side lights on stage will be on. Some of those numbers are references rather than things that are actually happening in them. Like from the dive, it runs to the end of the whole tape.
Yes, nice.
Okay.
Can I have your autograph on my program?
Sure. The Sydney piece is a series of 8 projections in one room at the same time, called I Am Not Me, The Horse Is Not Mine, with music by Philip Miller. And one understands that these are simply torn pieces of black paper arranged in a certain way. And is it about a generosity of viewing to see these torn pieces of paper make a coherent whole? Or is it an inability of ourselves to stop these fragments coming together? This is a section of I Am Not Me, The Horse Is Not Mine. And the title comes from a Russian peasant saying, denying guilt. If you're accused of something, you'd simply say, I am not me, the horse was not mine. In other words, I didn't steal the horse. Who wrote these notes? I mean, none of this makes sense. What is our edge? They're satellite pieces, but they're not only satellite pieces. It's material that's been excavated while working on the opera that then has its own place. So it's either like a kind of a footnote to the opera, or an essay about
I'm not
opera.
Meant to be doing this stuff. What am I doing on top of this ladder the whole time? None of these is any good here. Brackets. Prolonged laughter. Uproar in the room.
But in some ways you can turn it on its head and say the whole opera production is simply a provocation to arrive at this piece, because in fact the opera has 7 performances. After that, that's it. Whereas this already has had a much longer life than the opera will ever have.
Compilation.
No.
That's fine. Just want to use this for the soundtrack. First passage is just the horse by itself, and then the horse is going to come in and stand like a circus horse, and then he's going to rear up, at which point I disappear and the front step ladder disappears, and it's just my legs with an animated horse on top. So the back horse rears, and then I leap up.
This goes is
up.
Coming on now.
Yeah, but they're on together, obviously, at the same time.
They come. They follow each other on.
See, that's what I forgot about, that damn ladder. Oh, no, it's actually possible to do it that way. When that guy at the back does his lean up, then the front guy disappears and we just have the ladder by itself. Here I advance the image one, two frames, and then shift the horse, the paper horse, along. When I shoot it with a camera to reshoot what's being projected with the addition of the extra elements, I'm also shooting two frames. We rely on a similarity of shape and tone to make the viewer not understand that we suddenly changed medium. Hi. Hi, boy. Okay. Thank you. We'll just get this guy up and then we'll stop.
I think one does think with one's hands, and I think that's why a keyboard is not a good place for me to think. Some people think very well on a keyboard. I need this kind of the fidgeting of charcoal or scissors or tearing or something in my hands, as if there's a different brain that is controlling how that works. There's an uncertainty of what you're doing, an imprecision, so that what you do when you look at it is not know something in advance which you're carrying out, but rather rely on recognizing something as it appears. What I can do, but only as well as anybody else in the world can do, is recognize things as they appear. So it's not that I'm better at recognizing eight pieces of paper as a horse than anyone else. What I do is allow myself the luxury of saying, this is going to be the way I'm going to spend months and years of my life, is arranging stupid pieces of paper and they're saying, ah, a horse, every day, as if it's something fresh.
Okay, here we take a pause for lunch.
Come on, Tamino. Yeah,
come on. The seriousness of play is important in the work I do, and it's important as a strategy for allowing images and ideas to emerge. It's about saying in the looseness of trying different things. And it is, you know, terrible that one associates that looseness or open-endedness with childhood, that after that, that possibility of exploring something, not knowing quite where it will lead to, understanding one can do things lightly and quickly. It's not exactly frowned upon, but it's not the norm. All the interesting ideas I've ever had, or interesting work I've done, has always been against ideas I've had. It's always kind of been in between the things I thought I was doing that the real work has happened.
Educational resources, please visit us online at pbs.org. Art 21, Art in the 21st Century, is available on Blu-ray and DVD. The companion book is also available. To order, visit us online at shoppbs.org or call PBS Home Video at 1-800-PLAY-PBS.